What's up, Navigating Academia family? This is Dr. J. Phoenix Singh here to be able to answer a valued viewer's question. First of all, thank you guys so much to those of you who are subscribers. If you have not subscribed to the channel yet, please be sure to do so if you enjoy our content. And take a second, it's totally free to you, smash that like button. It helps us to be able to make sure that YouTube shows our content to as many individuals as possible who are not yet subscribers. You guys know my personal mission is to be able to help as many people as possible in academia, so please do me a favor, smash that like button, help me fulfill that mission, I appreciate you. So today's question is a response to Dominic. Dominic, thank you so much, mate, for watching. I appreciate it. I appreciate your kind words. To be able to summarize Dominic's question, he was curious about what I think the best mindset is to have when you want to pursue an academic career and you're in your 20s. Your 20s is a formative period. I can tell you that I remember when I used to live in Switzerland, which is back in 2013, when I lived there full time. I had a colleague of mine, so I'm a psychologist, she was a psychologist as well, and her name was Isolde Eckley, and Eckley was amazing, one of the best therapists that I've ever worked with in my life. And Eckley gave me a lot of wisdom, I would say. She gave me some harsh criticism at the time, which helped me grow a lot, so that's never a bad thing, but also gave me a lot of pearls of wisdom. And she was in her mid-70s when I knew her, so it made perfect sense age-wise in terms of her seeing me at a very young age of what, I was like 24, 25, to be able to give me some really solid advice. And what Eckley told me was that over the course of her, you know, 50-plus years in the field, that she was convinced that the worst decade of your entire life is your 20s. Which is ironic, because growing up, I feel like your 20s was always supposed to be this magical time where, you know, all these big things happen to you and you're finally an adult and you can go to parties and you can go out and you can, you know, go to clubs and bars and you can drink and these sorts of things. At least in the States, you can't drink until you're 21. And so it's one of those situations where I thought to myself, wow, you know, the 20s is going to be great. And the 20s for me, I can tell you right now, were terrible. Why were they terrible? Because I was busting my butt the entire decade. To me, family is incredibly important. I decided to do life a little bit backwards, and so far as I got my doctorates, both of them in my 20s, I started and sold my first company when I was also in my 20s and retired at the age of 30, and then a couple of years later, here I am back again, basically, because I got nothing else to do. And this is my favorite thing to be able to talk about, and it's such a blessing to be able to spend this time with you, and now I've got this great company, Publication Academy, which is gonna launch in January, which we've already been running beta tests on for the last year or so. So I can tell you that this is really the dream to be able to come back and do this and spend all of my time training and teaching passionate individuals like yourself. But I actually agree with Eckley looking back, because my friends who didn't do things backwards, who just did things kind of in the normal progression of life, they also had a very challenging time. They really didn't realize, just like I also didn't realize, that there are so many big things that happen in your 20s that you're kind of unprepared for. You're in the middle of between kind of being a teenager and being an adult. You're trying to figure out what that means. You're navigating life after college, and you're starting to realize that after you get your degree, your first degree, not even your graduate degrees, etc., you're at the bottom of the totem pole completely. And all of a sudden, unlike in college where everybody was your same age, you got people who've been in the game, you know, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years more than you have, directly competing with you, and they're not just going to give up power, and they're not just going to let you rise easily. And so that kind of competition and the tough life lessons that come with it can be a significant challenge. So how is it that if you decide to be able to pursue a career in academia, what's the mindset that I think you need to have? What kind of attitude and emotional framework do you need to have? Because in my belief system is that in your 20s, you develop what I call an emotional budget. Everybody thinks about financial budgeting, and that's a great idea. And I do believe in your 20s, honestly, the best thing you can do, at least for, you know, my perspective, is to be able to save up as much money as you can. Save up, start investing. Learn as much about investing as you can. I'm a big stocks guy. I also run a real estate fund of funds with some colleagues. So it's one of these situations where I'm very heavily involved in that world. And it's something where I learned all of it. I had no financial literacy. I learned it all from reading books, and by making mistakes and having big successes in those realms. but you gotta put some skin in the game. You gotta put that time in. If all you're doing is going out and partying and drinking and carrying on and these sorts of things, and you know, having relationships and this kind of stuff is a blessing and amazing, but if you make all of your 20s about going out and getting laid and these sorts of things, this is not the way to do things. I'm just telling you right now. Could be fun at the time, but I can tell you right now that, you know, 10, 20, 30 years later, the people who are grinding in their 20s, those are the folks who end up succeeding, and everybody else ends up working for them. I know, because this is essentially what happened with me as well, and I see all my friends and kind of what ended up happening for them, and they're helping somebody else's dreams come true, somebody who is grinding in their 20s. There's a great statement, which I always love. Actually, there's two of them. One of them is somebody says, hey, you know, I never see you at the club. And the other person says, I never see you at the bank. Right? So I really like that one. And there's another one, which is a Peña quote. Right? And the quote is, I do the things that you don't want to do, that you know you've got to do to be where you want to be. Right? These are those long nights in grad school. If you're in grad school right now, you know exactly what I'm talking about. This is you know, crying in the fetal position in the corner because you're trying to master propensity scoring and you got nobody to teach you. This is the kind of stuff, right? Now, luckily, that would never happen to me, but I have a lot of friends where something very similar did happen, right? So it's one of those things where in your 20s, this is the mindset that I believe you need to develop. Number one is emotional budgeting, right? And emotional budgeting is this idea that just like a financial budget, you need to make predictions about what's going to happen in your life. And the older that you get, the more that you realize that things aren't going to go super smoothly all the time. So for example, and also just in terms of you as a human being, like for me, it's something where if I get frustrated with a task, like a really monumental, a monolithic task, what happens for me is that I get really, 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 really stressed, and then I basically just crash. And when I say crash, what I mean is I'm just like, you know what, screw this, I don't want to do it, right? And then as I'm coming out of that, because then I'm super chill after that, right? As I'm coming out of it, then all of a sudden I'm super chill, and I, you know, get all these little light bulbs going off in my head, and then I can do whatever the thing is. I can write the paper, I can write the grant proposal, I can, you know, write the book proposal, I can do all these sorts of things. I can reformat the thousands of PowerPoint slides. I can do that kind of stuff after that. But I need to go up and crash first. That's just the way that I am. I wish it wasn't, and I've gotten a lot better over time, but something like that usually happens. So I can emotionally budget for that. I can emotionally budget for the fact that things are supposed to take a certain amount of time, but usually because I end up watching YouTube or doing different things or, you know, playing around with the channel, it's going to take me maybe a couple hours longer. That may end up taking one full calendar day longer. As you get to know yourself better, make sure, of course, that you try to address your weaknesses, but it's much more important, I believe, to encourage and foster your own strengths. So the second piece here, which I would say is deeply, deeply important to me that you understand, is what I call the 1.83% principle, okay? So you may say, like, you know, what the heck are you talking about, right? So this is just something that for me, I developed, you know, this idea when I started my first company when I was 26 or 27. And the idea is pretty simple, actually, which is that 9 out of 10 startups fail, right? Which is just kind of like a generic number people throw out there. It's more nuanced, but that's what they say, right? And only 17% of all companies, right, are started by CEOs who are in their 20s. So I was in my 20s, right? I started this company, meaning that I had a 1.83% chance of success. Now, there's a huge difference between arrogance and confidence. I'm a big believer that if you want to be successful in something, you need to be two things. Number one is confident, and number two is naive. If you are naive enough to believe that you can do something when all the odds are against you, right, then that means that the confidence that you have, even though it may technically be misplaced, it's that Steve Jobs quote, right, this idea that, you know, the crazy ones, the ones who are crazy enough to believe that they can change the world, are the ones who often do. And I want you to go in with this mindset of, okay, this is great. Yes, you're right, the overwhelming preponderance of people fail, but 1.83% of people become raging gangbuster successes. If you don't go into a career, if you don't go into anything in this life with the perception that you are going to succeed, you're going to do whatever it takes to be able to hit that goal, if you're just kind of laissez-faire and you're complacent and, you know, you are where you want to be, I think that's great. Why? Because 95% of people, never forget this, 95% of people are totally and utterly average. And that's fine. And that's great. There's nothing wrong with that. It takes all sorts in this world to be able to keep the world going, right? Like, that's really, really important. And the question is, are you willing to sustain suffering for a significant period of time to be able to build and develop something that is greater than the sum of its parts, that actually helps and provides services to other individuals to make their lives easier? And this can be done through research, through clinical work, and so forth. It depends what your goals are. And so, for example, you know, the individual who asked this question is doing a clinical, or is desiring to do a clinical psychology doctorate and subsequently become a full-time academic. That's what they're very passionate about. So think about the things that you need to be able to do that. So here we're talking about things like, you know, professional service, serving on boards locally at your university, maybe becoming a department chair. You can rise up the ranks in an association in your field, in your country, or internationally, and serve on the executive board. You can get involved with journals as an editorial board member, as an editor-in-chief, you know, so on and so forth. There's so many different options and opportunities to be able to get actively involved, right? So that's professional service. Same thing, publishing everything you can get your, you know, mind around and your hands on in terms of data, right? And making sure that you're making more seminal contributions. I really focused in my early 20s on trying to figure out what are the biggest things I can do. Large-scale epidemiological studies, publishing white papers, publishing large-scale meta-analyses and systematic reviews, these sorts of studies, large-scale international surveys, these things that I knew were going to be cited a lot. So by doing that, you know, usually it's anywhere in psychology, having an H index of like 6 to 10, you need at least that before you can actually go up for associate professor. My H index is 29, right? Why? Because in my early 20s, I spent that time grinding. I had a mentor once who told me at dinner, and she just said, you know, it's like, don't you want to be out like partying and like these sorts of things? You're so young. Because when I finished my first doctorate, I think it was, what, 23? Right, in terms of from Oxford in psychiatry. And it's one of these things where, like, on the one hand, like, trust me, I went out, this was not a problem. But at the same time, that wasn't the focus that I had. My focus was on grinding and getting somewhere. And I can tell you that right now, when I'm filming this, I'm 34. At the age of 30, when I retired, it was one of these things where I was just like, you know, what the heck do I do now? I had to find a new life, a new dream, a new all these sorts of things, new ways to be able to spend my time, to be able to be philanthropically involved, to be able to start investing systematically, even more so than I was always already doing, and so forth, right? But that's that attitude that you've got to have, is that I will be one of that 1.83% of people who actually succeeds, whether it's starting a company or whether it's being an academic. And it means putting in every hour. It means, like, this is Elon Musk talks about, he's like, just work like hell every waking hour. That's what he says. I totally agree. And most people won't do that. And most people don't want to. And you should never, ever, ever shame or blame those people or make them feel bad for not wanting to do it. That's okay. To be honest with you, I think you gotta be a little bit nuts to want to do it in the first place. I think you gotta be a little bit crazy. I'm a little bit nuts in that way. Entrepreneurial spirit, like, if you really wanna do it, not having like a side hustle, right? Having a side hustle, people wanna say that they're entrepreneurs. This is a wantrepreneur. They want to be an entrepreneur, right? That's it, this is the overwhelming preponderance. If you quit your job, move back in with your parents in your mid-20s, like I did, right, with $13,000 in your pocket and a big ol' idea, and then realize that you're totally and utterly unprepared and you have no idea what you're doing, and you quit a six-figure job to be able to move home and do it, and then you actually somehow managed to pull it off, which I'm still shocked. I was the one who did it, and I'm still looking at myself from the outside being like, is that a thing? Like, that's crazy to me, right? But it's a situation where if I can do it, you can do it too, okay? That's like the big thing here. When it comes to academia, when it comes to business needs, if it's possible for me, this means that it's possible for you too. And I'm here for you every step of the way to be able to support you, to be able to motivate you. If you're ever having trouble with imposter syndrome or needing motivation or just needing some fuel on that fire, just book a session with me via the website below. Let's talk and let's get you motivated for the next big thing in your life. Okay? Thank you so much for your question, mate. Thank you to everybody for watching. Be sure to subscribe to the channel, like this video, and I will see you in the next one. Peace.